Hello friends, in this video we will discuss about the saliva and its role in prosthodontics. So saliva is composed of 99.5% water and 0.5% solids, which includes 0.2% organic and 0.3% inorganic substances. It constitutes of various cellular constituents like yeast, bacteria, descomated epithelial cells and leukocytes, then salivary enzymes, mucoproteins and glycoproteins, blood group substances, carbohydrates, nitrogenous compounds like urea, lipids, immunoglobulins like IgA, IgG and IgM, and various inorganic substances like sodium, phosphate, etc. So various salivary enzymes are amylase, lysozymes, lactoferrin, xyloperoxidase, peroxides and lipase, acid phosphatase and cholecrein. So coming to the properties of saliva, the daily flow is 500 to 1500 milliliter. It is slightly acidic in nature with a mean pH of 6.4. Saliva is a colorless opalescent liquid with a specific gravity of 1.002 to 1.012. It is hypotonic in nature. The flow rate is 0.01 milliliter per minute at rest and 7 milliliter per minute in stimulated saliva. The osmotic pressure is 700 to 1000 milliosmol per liter, and the freezing point is minus 0.07 to minus 0.34 degree centigrade. So saliva helps in mastication and deglutition. It helps in lubrication and protection of the oral mucosa. It helps in dilution and clearance of debris. It provides an antibacterial effect. It helps in remineralization of teeth. Then it helps in pellicle and plaque formation. It possesses a neutralizing and buffering action. And it helps in digestion of food because of the presence of various enzymes. So in this chart you can see the functions of various constituents of saliva. Like we can see that bicarbonate and phosphate provides a buffering action, while mucins, calcium and phosphate prevents demineralization of teeth. Stearin, calcium and phosphate enhances the remineralization, while mucins help in lubrication of mucosa. Then cystatins, mucins and immunoglobulins provide an antiviral effect. Cystatins and immunoglobulins are antifungal. Lysozyme, lactoferrin, kelp protection, lactoperoxidase and immunoglobulins provides an antibacterial effect. Then various enzymes like amylase, protease, lipase, DNAs and RNAs helps in digestion. Then gustin helps in taste perception, and mucins and water helps in bolus formation. So as we know that the major organic substance of tooth is hydroxyapatite crystals. Now these hydroxyapatite contains phosphate in the form of phosphate ions. These ions cannot dissolve or go in solution at physiological pH values because saliva is already supersaturated with calcium and phosphate ions. So what happens when salivary pH falls? Whenever salivary pH falls, the saliva is no longer supersaturated. This results in decreased salivary phosphate ion level, which further decreases the pH, and it results in release of phosphate ions from hydroxyapatite crystals. So in this slide we can see that the major contribution comes from submandibular gland. In rest position, submandibular gland contributes approximately 65% of the salivary flow, followed by parotid, sublingual and minor glands. In cases of stimulated flow rates, the parotid contributes more than 50% of total salivary secretion. So the salivary flow follows a circadian rhythm. It is less during summers and it increases during winters, while it is less in night and it increases during the daytime. The salivary flow is less in maxillary region and it is more in mandibular region. So hypersalivation is a condition when the unstimulated flow rate is below 0.1 ml, and this condition is also known as xerostomia. So the etiology includes various physiological factors like dehydration, aging, distasteful stimuli, or presence of rough objects. Then autoimmune or systemic diseases like Sjögren syndrome, primary biliary cirrhosis, sarcoidosis, and diabetes, etc. Medicines like opioids, NSAIDs, anticholinergic drugs, antihistaminics, antidepressants, antihypertensive agents, and muscle relaxants. Neurological disorders like Alzheimer's disease, then local radiation therapy, presence of anxiety and depression, and atrophy of salivary glands. So in case of complete denture, the retention is affected because of the absence of saliva. Then frictional irritation to the denture supporting tissues. There will be difficulty in mastication and deglutition, and patient may discontinue the use of dentures because of the discomfort. Coming to the management of xerostomia, the treatment will depend upon the nature of the disease. The cause should be detected and corrected. Drug-related hypofunction can be minimized by lowering the doses or changing the medication in consultation with the patient's physician. Sugarless gums and candies containing citric acids can be used, and frequent sips of water and sucking ice chips diminishes the discomfort. The aggressive use of oral hygiene measures should be initiated. Fluoride and antibacterial agents can be used. Sorbitol or xylitol sweetened products can be used, which further decreases the risk of candidiasis. Various xylococcus like pilocarpine or sevimeline can be used. Then saliva substitutes or artificial saliva can be given, and salivary reservoir can be given in complete denture patients. So here we can see that the pilocarpine is a muscarinic cholinergic agonist, which is given 5 mg 4 times a day orally. It is indicated in case of radiation-induced xerostomia and Sjögren syndrome, and contraindicated in cases of uncontrolled asthma, acute iritis, or narrow-angle glaucoma. The sevimeline is an acetylcholine analog. It is given 30 mg 3 times a day orally, and it is indicated in Sjögren syndrome. The contraindications are same as pilocarpine, with significant history of cardiovascular and pulmonary diseases. So various salivary substitutes are available in forms of sprays and lozenges. It includes carboxymethyl cellulose-based substitutes, which contains carboxymethyl cellulose, xylitol, potassium phosphate, potassium chloride, and sodium chloride in 100 ml of water. Prosin-mucin-based substitute, which contains prosin-mucin, xylitol, methylparaben, EDTA, benzyl conium chloride, sodium chloride in 100 ml of water. Milk helps in lubrication of tissues and increases the pleasure of eating. It also has buffering capacity, so milk should be given. Then various artificial salivary reservoir can be made in the complete dentures. It helps in storing the artificial saliva. The saliva escapes continuously through the holes. The reservoirs can be cleaned with a syringe by patient or by dentist, and it be refilled with artificial saliva that contain mucin. In 2 to 12 hours, refilling may be required. The prosthesis can be opened and the reservoir can be cleaned under running water. If the holes are blocked with food particles, they need to be cleaned with an instrument. Then hypersalivation is the condition when there is excess saliva. The etiology includes various digestive tract irritants, vitamin deficiency, and trauma from surgery. The drugs that increases the salivation include cholinesterase inhibitors like prostaglandin, adrenergic stimulating drugs like epinephrine, and xylococcus like pilocarpine. In denture wearers, it is due to emotional stress, painful affliction of the oral cavity, and reflex stimulation of the dentures. This may be due to incorrect centric jaw relation registration, excessive vertical dimensions, overextension of denture borders, or in case of pain and excessive pressure on oral mucosa. Pressure on nerves and their terminals, than in cases of new dentures and when there is excessive thickness of the dentures. The management includes correction of the dentures and local anesthesia which block nerve impulses from the periodontal ligament. Anti-psilogox can be given like propanthiolene bromide, glycopyrrolate, atropine sulfate, dicyclomine HCl and clonidine. They are administered 30 to 60 minutes before the drying effect is required. Anticholinergic drugs are contraindicated in patients with heart disease or glaucoma. Coming to the prosthodontic implications, so the excess salivation presents a problem in impression making procedures. Mucus secretions from the palatal glands may distort the impression materials in the posterior two-thirds of the palate, causing dislodgement of the denture. It may result in voids on the impression surface and gagging in the patient. To counteract this problem, the palate may be massaged to encourage the glands to empty. The mouth may be irrigated with an astringent mouthwash just before inserting the impression material. The palate may be wiped with gauze, and warm gauze pads may be used to milk palatal glands followed by cold pads to constrict the gland openings. Anti-psilogox in combination with mouth rinses and gauze packs may be used. 15 mg propanthiolene bromide tablet 30 minutes before the impression can be given. It is contraindicated in cases of medical conditions such as glaucoma, prosthetic hypertrophy and cardiac conditions. Coming to the cleaning of alginate impression. So if the saliva is thin and serous in nature, then the impression can be held under a gentle stream of cool tap water. And if the saliva is thick and ropey in nature, then first we need to sprinkle a thin layer of dental stone on the impression surface. Then it can be washed under a gentle stream of cool tap water. In cases of fixed partial denture patients, the isolation can be achieved by using rubber dam if the margins are supragingival in nature, or by the use of absorbent cotton rolls, moisture absorbing cords, saliva evacuators and pseudopter. In patients with xerostomia, the lips should be coated with petroleum jelly to help with retraction and access to the oral cavity. The operator's fingers should be wetted to prevent them from sticking to the oral tissues, and a mirror should be used to facilitate insertion of the tray as it is less bulky than the fingers. In patients with xerostomia, the primary impression should be made in alginate or elastomeric impression material. Impression compound should be avoided. The bottom molding should be done with putty elastomeric impression material, and the final impression can be made in elastomeric impression material or alginate. Zinc oxide eugenol should be avoided as it sticks to the dry tissues and cause burning sensation. Now coming to the role of saliva in denture retention. So in this case, various factors which need to be considered are interfacial surface tension, adhesion, cohesion, capillary attraction and atmospheric pressure. The interfacial surface tension is the resistance to separation of two parallel surfaces that is imparted by a film of liquid between them. It is dependent on the ability of the fluid to wet the rigid surrounding materials. So in cases of material with low surface tension, the wetting will be more. So the wettability of heat polymerized denture based resin is more as compared to chemically polymerized resin. It may not play an important role in retaining the mandibular denture as it does for the maxillary denture. Coming to the viscosity, the interfacial viscous tension refers to the force holding two parallel plates together due to the viscosity of the interposed liquid. It can be calculated by using Stefan's law. The viscous force increases proportionally to increase in the viscosity of the interposed liquid, but decreases on increase in its thickness. The viscosity of saliva helps in prevention of denture dislodgement. As the denture is pulled away from the tissues, saliva is drawn into the space being created beneath the denture. A retentive force is generated by resistance to flow of saliva, resulting from the viscous properties of saliva and the dimensions of the channel through which it flows. Coming to the adhesion and cohesion, As we know, the adhesion is the attraction between two opposite molecules, and the cohesion is the attraction between two like molecules. So the adhesion is achieved through ionic forces between the charged salivary glycoproteins and the surface epithelium or acrylic resin, meaning the adhesion is between the acrylic resin and saliva and saliva and the denture based resin. The amount of retention provided by adhesion is proportionate to the area covered by the denture. Hence, it is of lower magnitude in cases of mandibular dentures and small basal seat area, because the surface area of mandibular arch is less as compared to maxillary arch. Cohesion occurs between the layers of saliva that is present between the denture base and mucosa, and works by maintaining the integrity of the interposed liquid. The contribution to retention is low. Coming to the capillary attraction, it is the force that causes a liquid to rise in a capillary tube, because in this physical setting, the liquid tries to maximize its contact with the walls of the capillary tube, thereby rising along the tube wall at the interface between the liquid and the glass. When the denture is adjusted on the tissue surface, a space of about 0.1 mm is created between the denture and the mucous membrane. The denture is attracted to the mucous membrane by a force whose magnitude responds to the difference of the attraction of the exterior atmosphere and the saliva under the denture. So, in order to achieve this, we need a very thin layer of saliva between the tissues and the denture. Atmospheric pressure. When the denture is dislodged from the basal seat, a lower atmospheric pressure is formed under the denture in comparison with the pressure of the surrounding atmosphere. The force created by the difference in pressure pushes the denture against the basal seat. Thank you.